Hello friends, welcome back to the tetrahedron chemistry classes. So in the series of the name, reactions and the reagent, today I am going to explain this Luche reduction. And this Luche reduction is of immense importance when you go for the distereoselective type of the synthesis, especially in the organic synthesis, right? So in every alternate examination of CSIR NET or in the GATE examination, you will find the question based on this Luche reagent or directly from the Luche reduction. So it is very important to understand how the mechanism goes for this reaction and how we can decide the product actually. So if the most general use of Luche reduction, if we want to check here, so it is nothing but it is the chemoselective conversion of alpha beta unsaturated ketone to the allylic alcohol, right? And this would form according to the 1-2 kind of addition, right? Why I'm calling it as stereo chemoselective synthesis, because this sodium boron hydride in presence of your lanthanides, right, especially the lanthanides chlorides, and more general use is what, cerium chloride. Actually, in the presence of this cerium chloride, actually the chemoselectivity of the sodium borohydride increases manifold, and it will reduce only the carbonyl part, while it will not touch other parts like your ester. If there, it will not touch that ester. Similarly, it will not touch the aldehyde, it will not touch the double bond in general in presence of the cerium chloride, right? So, and the reagent, as I mentioned already, sodium borohydride and cerium chloride, and then you use any solvent like alcohol as any solvent, right? As solvent. So whether you use methanol or ethanol, and sometimes you can also add a little water to it, right? So these are the conditions, reagents and the reactions. So why I am saying 1-2 kind of addition is this. So if you see, if the first reaction, so what is happening here, you see it is alpha beta unsaturated carbonyl compound. This is the functional group. If you see, then this is your alpha, this is your beta. So you are finding that there is unsaturation at the alpha and the beta position, okay? And if you see the product, actually in this product, this double bond is not getting disturbed by this sodium boron hydride in presence of the cerium chloride, while only this, the carbonyl, that means this ketonic group actually is converting into the OH group. So what you are forming, the allylic alcohol. So the most general use of Luche reduction is that the formation of the allylic alcohol from the your alpha beta unsaturated carbonyl compounds, or say other carbonyl compounds in which you have the double bond, in which you have the triple bond, as well as your ester hydroxy group. So it will not touch any other group except your this carbonyl moiety, okay? And why I'm calling it as a 1-2 addition, if you number it, this oxygen will get the number 1, and this carbon, which is directly attached to this oxygen, it will get the number 2, and this alpha position is the 3, and this is the 4. So here you are adding one hydrogen at position number 1, right? And you are adding hydrogen at position number 2. So 1-2 kind of addition is there. Actually, you can check, one hydrogen is hidden here, right? In that manner I can write this. So right now it is not necessary to decide the stereochemistry of that particular hydrogen, but I'll come to the stereochemistry aspect also when I'll solve the CSIR net problem, right, later in the lecture actually. Okay, now similarly, if you move to the second kind of the reaction, again you can see it is alpha beta unsaturated carbonyl compound, and if you number it, then 1, 2, 3, 4 under again the same condition. Here I am writing LnCl3, that means lanthanide chlorides, but I am writing lanthanide chloride here, but most general use is what, actually the cerium chloride, okay? So again you can see this double bond is not getting disturbed by the reaction with the sodium borohydride, but this carbonyl compound is actually getting into the alcohol. Again you are getting what, allylic alcohol. Okay, similarly, if you go to the third reaction, then again it's a molecule here, and see, you are having this carbonyl oxygen here, and again this is what, you are this system double bond, again it is 1, 2, 3, 4, and you are getting this product, not getting this double bond is not getting disturbed, but you are getting the OH here, again the allylic alcohol you are forming. Okay, the reason is that why I have written this particular example, you can see the yield of that particular compound. So 97% desired product you are getting in this reaction. That means this Luche reduction is a very clean reaction actually. It's a very clean reaction, right? Clean reaction means you are getting your desired product in the very, very high amount. While see, however, you have other reducing agents also. So if you want to use your lithium aluminium hydride in place of the sodium borohydride, what would happen? Your double bond would also get oxidized. If you use the lithium aluminium hydride, then you will have the 1,4 addition and 1,2 addition both simultaneously, and then you will have the mixture of the compound and the separation. You need to separate that compound, and further you see the yield of that the desired compound would decrease when such parallel reactions are there. That's why this Luche reduction is of immense importance in the organic synthesis. Fine. Similarly, if you move here, this is another example. This example again is very, very beautiful one. Why beautiful one? You can see this I have written is OAC. OAC, you know, it is what? CH3. C double bond O, O. It's an acetate part actually. Similarly, this part is also acetate. And if you see this one, this is benzoate part. That means C6H5, C double bond O. So that means ester moiety is also there. Double bond is also there. And this carbonyl system is also there. And you are doing the Luche reduction with the help of the sodium borohydride, cerium chloride, and then ethanol. Of course, you are taking this dichloromethane also here as a solvent. Right, but it will not make any difference in the reaction actually. And you see the product here. In the product, again, what is happening here? It is giving you 1,2 kind of addition, right? Because double bond is not getting disturbed. Only this carbonyl group is actually converting into your alcohol. See, the product acetate part is not going to disturb. Similarly, this will also not disturb, and this benzoate would remain as such always. So that means it is the use of the Luche reduction when you have the various kinds of the functional group present in the molecule. Fine. Then selectively, chemoselectively, you can reduce only your carbonyl group into the alcohol one. This is the utility of the Luche reduction. So this is how the reaction goes. But the important part is that the clear cut mechanism of this reaction, Luche reduction. However, if you see lots of the textbook, this mechanism is not actually explained correctly. What I will do, I will explain this mechanism correctly. So if you want to see, if you want to learn the reaction mechanism, how it goes, and if you want to learn the core organic chemistry, so there are various websites present in the web actually. The one is, you see, the organic chemistry portal, and then like this organic chemistry portal, you have SIN archive actually, synthesis archive, right? In these websites, you will find the many examples of the synthesis with every kind of the reactions, every reagents, every year protecting group. So you can see there, right? So now first I am going to explain the general mechanism of that Luche reduction. So how it goes, you can see. Okay. So again, it's very, very important. So say this is my alcohol, ROH. So I am explaining the mechanism in the general way, very general way. So this is R here. You can consider it as methyl as methanol or ethyl as ethanol, right? And then you are having a cerium chloride. You have used your cerium chloride. Ce3 positive, it's a lanthanide, and you know it's a positively charged species, right? Cation, and cation always act as the Lewis acid. That means the cerium chloride is actually your Lewis acid. Or Lewis acid, by definition, you know they are the electron pair acceptor. If they are the electron pair acceptor, they will always search for the electrons. So what happens, you see here, the lone pair present on the oxygen atom actually coordinates with this cerium ion and make this coordinated species, right? You can write your cerium 3 positive here. Okay, this is how you can make it. And of course, two lone pair were there on it, and it is coordinating here. Clear? So what happens actually, if you see this lone pair is actually donated to the cerium, so what would happen? This lone pair would go to this one. As a result of this, actually this hydrogen is getting slight more positively charged, and this hydrogen now becomes more acidic. You know your alcohols are acidic in nature, but this methanol or this ethanol alone is not a very, very good acid, so that it can remove H positive from here, especially when come in contact with the sodium boron hydride, okay, or with any other reagent, right? So what is this cerium is doing? Actually, it is increasing the acidity of this hydrogen of alcohol, that is your solvent. So this is very, very important to understand actually. Now, if I am saying that this is the step number one, then you can go for the step number two. So what happens in the step number two? Say this was your alcohol and this was your hydrogen and this was your cerium 3 positive ion, and I already explained this is more positive due to this coordination actually, right? And of course then you will have your boron hydride, that is BH4 negative, right? So how I am getting this BH4 negative? It's quite simple. You have used sodium borohydride, NaHBO4, sorry, NaBH4, and if you ionize this, it will give you Na positive and BH4 negative. So this negative is the residual charge which is present on the boron, right? So I have written the negative on it. So now you have seen the acidity of this hydrogen actually increased by many fold with the help of this cerium, right? So what happens, this hydrogen can remove from here as a positively charged species, and this boron hydride actually, this sodium borohydride is what? It's a nucleophilic reagent. It's a nucleophilic reagent. Why it's a nucleophilic reagent? Because it will produce H negative ion, nucleus loving species, that is the hydride ion. So what happens, this hydrogen along with its electron pair will attack on this hydrogen which would be removed from here as a proton, and this electron pair actually goes back to the oxygen, and then what you have here this BH3 molecule, and this BH3 is what? It is already a Lewis acid because it is electron deficient compound, so it will always search the electrons, right? And what you left then you left your R and this your oxygen with negative sign. This negative sign is actually coming by the breaking of this bond, and of course the coordinated cerium is there, and you have removed hydrogen. Okay, so this is the key step actually. If you don't use your cerium here and you directly react your alcohol with your sodium boron hydride like that, if you want to do this particular one, ROH plus BH4 negative, and if you want to remove hydrogen from here, right, along with your RO negative plus BH3, so this reaction actually impossible. Why impossible? Because this hydrogen of the alcohol is not that acidic so that it can be removed by the very weak hydride producing sodium boron hydrides. So this reaction is not possible. That's why we have added the cerium 3 positive ion into the reaction mixture. Fine. This is very important to understand. Okay. Now, if you move further, say in the third step, what would happen? You have this BH3, B, H and H. This is your BH3. And in the system, you are having your next species R, O negative, and this coordinated cerium 3 positive ion. So what happened? These two can react further. If these two can see, this boron is what? It is electron deficient compound, right? So it will require what? It will require the electron pair. So what happened? This actually cerium goes off from here, and this negatively charged oxygen will attack on the boron to form this kind of species. This is boron and the three hydrogen attached to it, and this is OBR. Actually, it is believed that this mechanism goes through the boron ethoxide or boron alkoxide mechanism. So this is boron, this is alkoxide linkage. Of course, it will get a negative because it has accepted the electron pair from here and setting this cerium ion as free species. Now this species is this step is very, very important. And what you can do, see, this hydrogen was this complex is again removed. This hydrogen, this particular hydrogen is hydride. Similarly, these two hydrogen can also be removed as the hydride. So what actually happens in the reaction, these steps are actually repeating steps. So I am writing it as repeating steps, okay, and I am writing it for three times. If the steps are repeating for the three times, that means you will have this kind of a species. what kind of species you will have? Boron, okay, and all ends, right, all the hydrogen would be substituted with this OR. Actually this you will have, but you can imagine in this way, in the middle somewhere you will have this kind of a species also, OBR, and OR, this is OR again, this is OR, and a hydrogen here. So there is obvious reason why I am drawing this particular structure, because later in the reaction I will need that hydrogen for further reaction. But you should keep in mind, actually this step is very very important for this reaction. Fine. Now if you have any starting material, of if you have your, say I am writing step number 4 actually, say if you have this particular compound, this is double bond oxygen, two lone pairs on it. Fine, I can write like this, and you see double bond is here, this is say R dash and this is R. Again this is what? Alpha beta unsaturated carbonyl compounds. Now one very important point which I would like to mention here, actually if you want to know correctly what is the mechanism for this Luche reduction, so you must have an idea about the HSAB principle, hard, soft, acid and bases. So for this you should know, hard acid would react with the hard base and soft acid would react with the soft base. So if you see this your starting material, then actually this carbon double bond carbon is actually your soft center. This center is soft. If you produce the positively charged species, then that positive end would be your soft acid, okay. And why it is the soft center? Because the this double bond is actually bonded with the two carbon atoms, both having the same electronegativity. So electron cloud is distributed between the two carbon atoms evenly. Now if you check this carbonyl actually, so this oxygen is what? It is very highly electronegative. If it is very very highly electronegative, that means all the electron cloud would be concentrated on the oxygen, right? So this carbon is actually what is getting positive. So due to this charge separation between carbon and the doubly bonded oxygen, this positively charged center is what? It is your hard center, right? That means it is what? Your hard acid actually, right? So it will react the hard base. Fine. And similarly you can see this oxygen, which would be more negative, right? Which would be more negative, that means it would be your hard base, then it will react your hard acid. So what happens, you see, now I am drawing this species H O R and a cerium ion coordinated here. This is the species which I have produced in the first step. You can check here actually, okay. Now this is more acidic due to this coordination, and this actually would react with this oxygen which is present on the carbonyl atom. So you should remember a very important point. The hydrogen which would be present in your product actually, and bonded with this oxygen, it is actually coming from the acid, okay. Then what would happen, you see, you will have this kind of species R dash, this is doubly bonded carbons, and this is R. Now I am giving it as double and hydrogen, and of course a positive here, and this already, you know, this is the positive species actually. So this species is quite important, and remember this is actually your hard center. So this is your hard actually acid, electron pair positive charge is there. So what I can do, see, remember what I have done previously, I have told you this species I will need somewhere. So now I am using that particular species. You know, this H negative, due to the presence of the three OH, three OR groups present here, this actually behaves as the hard base. So this behaves as the hard base. So this hard base would react with the hard acid. How? You see, this would come along with the electron pair and approaches to this center, and this would come up. So you will have your final product like that, R dash, this is double bond oxygen, and this was your R, Now this would become your OH. This electron pair has shifted there, so it's the lone pairs of this oxygen gets completed. And this hydride actually, which is coming from this boron, which would add, say, somewhere here, hydrogen, right? So this is your product, but you see this product actually is producing a chiral center here. So if the chiral center is there, that means you have to specify the stereochemistry of this incoming nucleophile, that means incoming this of this incoming hydrogen. But for right now, I am not interested in the stereochemistry. I will do in the later when I will solve the example with the help of this one. But you should remember, whenever I am drawing any group by putting this zigzag line, right, it means the stereochemistry is uncertain. Stereochemistry is not sure. So here stereochemistry is not sure. And you see, this is your allylic alcohol, right? Or say in the, this is actually your product. So if you want to do, so what would happen actually along with this one? You will have your BOR whole thrice. This species you will have. And this is again what? This is your Lewis acid. Because it is trivalent boron. So what can happen? This is there. What part I'm actually, okay, this particular one you see. This is there in the solution. This RO cerium. So what happened? I'm writing R here, O with negative sign, and coordinated cerium here, 3 positive. So what would happen? This cerium goes off from here, and this negatively charged species again attack with this boron. Sorry, it was not in the frame actually, right? So see, I am explaining again. Actually, this species was there in the solution. So RO cerium positive and negatively charged oxygen, actually this I have produced here actually. So this negative charge will attach to this boron, and your cerium would knocked out from this position, cerium 3 positive, and finally you will have BOR whole 4 with a negative sign. Okay, so this is the scheme of your Luche reduction mechanism, and it is very important to understand this kind of mechanism. However, if you want to solve the problem, it is not always necessary to know all these things, right? But in my view, actually, superficial knowledge is not very important. You should have the core knowledge about any aspect which you are studying here. So this actually very, very important mechanism for you guys. Fine. Now moving to the next things, you see. Okay, fine. Now I'm coming to this problem. Again, the very, very important one. Sorry, I have to adjust the papers. Okay, so this was the problem asked in the CSIR NET June 2015 examination, right? And you see, this compound is given to you, and you have used sodium boron hydride, cerium chloride, methanol and water, and you have to identify what product is going to form in the reaction, right? So you can see here, this is the option number A. So this option A, you can see here what it is doing actually. It is reducing this OH here, right? And as sorry, actually I have to check whether I have written that question correctly or not. Sorry, I have to check this one. Please wait for a while. I have to check. So in my notes, okay, very fine. Actually, this CHO is also there. Right, this is CHO. Now it is fine. Okay, so in the reaction you can see this aldehyde is actually converting into OH, and this carbonyl is also getting converted into OH. But you should know, these aldehyde cannot be converted under these conditions, actually under Luche reduction conditions. So this option cannot be your answer. However, you know, this ketonic group would be converted into the alcohol. It is converting, but it is also converting this CHO. So this is not possible actually. Now moving to the next example, again, you see this is also not possible, because you see OH is there. That means it is reducing this part, and it is forming a 6-7 membered ring. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 membered ring. So it is also not possible. Now moving to third one, if you see, okay, they are reducing this in the third option. You can check here, they are reducing this aldehyde group, but you know aldehyde cannot be reduced under such conditions, and it is not reducing actually the ketonic. So this is also not your answer. Fine, no problem in that. Now moving to the next problem, last option. Last option is what? You see your CHO remain as such, very fine, and your C double bond O is actually getting converting into OH group. Fine, it is very very important, but this D is the answer. Or in this particular question, don't bother about the stereochemistry, because in the options itself the stereochemistry is not given actually. So option 4 is there. And one very important thing I want to tell you, if you want to know the stereochemical aspects of these nucleophilic addition of the on the carbonyl groups, then you should know the Cram's rule. What is the Cram's rule? What is the Falcon N model? And to operate this Falcon N model, you should know the conformational aspects of the carbonyl group, how to draw the conformational aspects of the conformations of the carbonyl compounds also. If you don't know the conformations of the carbonyl group, Falcon N approach and your Cram's rule, don't bother about that. I will explain this in the separate video with the help of the lots of the examples. Okay, but anyway you can solve the problem in this way. Now moving to the next problem here, right? So this problem actually has been asked in the CSIR NET 2015 examination, and this actually a very very interesting question, and it's not the easy one actually, right? You have to apply lots of concept to solve this particular problem, but I can give you some hint how you can see. So this is what your alpha beta unsaturated carbonyl compounds, right? That means 1, 2, 3, and 4, right? So you know under these Luche conditions only 1,2 reduction would occur, while your third and fourth actually 1,4 addition will not occur. So this would not actually this double bond would not get reduced in the reaction. But in the option number C, you are observing this carbolyl is actually untouched while this double bond is reduced, so it is not possible under Luche's condition or Luche's reduction. Now moving to the next one, again the same thing is happening here. Carbon double bond, oxygen, they are not touching, but they are removing this double bond by adding the hydrogen here actually, right? So if they are at a reducing this one, this cannot be your answer. The only difference in the option A and option B is what? The stereochemistry of methyl is different. Here it is below the plane, here it is above the plane, but again this cannot be your answer. Okay, now moving to the third option, this is option number 3. So you can, if you compare this option number C with the product, double bond is not getting disturbed here, so it may be the answer, and you see this carbonyl is actually converting into the alcohol, so this could be your answer. Similarly, you can see the option number D. Option D can also be your answer, right? So now you have to select between C and D actually. Out of these two, one would be your correct answer, and here comes the stereochemistry and the Cram's rule. So if you know the Cram's rule, then it is very fine. If you don't know the Cram's rule, so I am giving you a slight hint for the Cram's rule. So first of all, what I am explaining you, the modified Cram's rule. Modified Cram's rule. So what this modified Cram's rule says that actually, okay. So you can see this, your starting material, this carbonyl group actually I'm showing this as downward, and you see these three groups are attached, so it is methyl actually. So to apply these Cram's rule or the Falcon N approach, you should know the conformational or the reactive conformations of the species. So what you can do, you can see this OPOPH2, right? This is actually phenyl, this is oxygen, this is phosphorus here. So this group is actually quite bulky, so you can consider this group as large group, okay? And this methyl actually is the medium group, and this hydrogen which is attached actually, this hydrogen is your, say, small group. So whenever the addition would occur, so your nucleophile, which you have seen in case of your boronhydride, H negative ion, this H negative ion either would attack to this carbonyl oxygen through this small group site or through this medium group side. However, it will never approach on this carbonyl carbon through the side of the large group, right? So this is actually medium, large and small groups. But modified Cramp's rule says that whenever the hetero atom is there in your molecule, then the stable conformation actually is the syn conformation. So this is the NT one. Why I am calling it is NT? Because this carbonyl group and this large group, they are NT to each other. That means they are forming the 180 degree angle. You can see it is going up, right? It is going down. So there is 180 degree angle between them. So they are NT to each other. So this is actually what? NT conformation. But what modified Cramp's rule says that if the hetero atom is there, this oxygen is the hetero atom here. So according to the modified Cramp's rules, this hetero atom containing group, whether it is large, small or whatever, it must be syn to the carbonyl group. So to make this as syn to this one, I have to rotate this bond. This particular bond, I have to rotate. So when I rotate this bond, what I will get here, you see, this is this part actually, okay. This is your carbonyl and this is this one. So if I rotate this particular one, hydrogen is actually here below the plane and this would come actually above the plane when I will rotate. So this hydrogen would take the position of this your phosphorus oxygen containing group. So I am writing this as hydrogen here and this PO PH2 which was actually above the plane, this would take the place of this methyl group during the rotation. So you will write oxygen here, this is P and your say 2 PH are there. So I can write this, I can write it in this way, fine. And lastly, you left with this the methyl group. So this methyl group actually would go below the plane. So this much of stereochemistry and the rotation of the molecule you must know to solve such kind of difficult problem. Okay. So this is actually the syn conformation. This is the syn conformation. Why syn? Because this large group which is containing this hetero atom oxygen, it is syn to this carbonyl group. And why it is necessary? So to place this large group as syn to this one for effective chelation. For effective chelation. Chelation, you know, chelation or chelate, chelating ligands, right? So chelation can occur here. How chelation can occur? Say if you have your say zinc here, so it can coordinate here, so chelation would occur, a cycle would form here. If you put your cerium here actually, so cerium again would undergo the chelation. So chelation actually fix the geometry here and then the further reaction would occur, fine. Now you have your species. So see, initially what I am doing, I am writing it in the correct way actually. So this I have explained in the mechanism, how this will go. This is double bond and this would be your oxygen and hydrogen. This would be positively charged. Now this would be opposite, okay, this one, and this is O P, and these are the two, say pH here. This is Me and this is H. Okay, so this I have explained in the mechanism. Where the mechanism is? Mechanism is here actually. So you can think here, I have made this species actually. That's why I am doing this also here, fine. And now this is the positively charged center. Now you have your hydride, that means negatively charged. From where it is coming? And again you can see this H negative is coming from this particular species which I have explained. Okay, now this would attack actually. See, it will never attack from the side where this bulky group is present. But see, if you use the Cramp's rule, right, if you use the Cramp's rule, then in the syn conformation, what the Cramp's rule says that, so you can see here what the Cramp's rule says, that if the large group is syn to the carbonyl group, in that case we are having that large group syn to the carbonyl, right, then the nucleophile would attack from the side of the medium group. Then the nucleophile would attack from the side of the medium group. Okay, So here you can see, in that case, same, that means this would attack from the side of the medium group, and your medium group is what? Your medium group is what? It is methyl. So it should approach from the below the plane. But remember, this is not the condition. Whenever this chelation is occurring in the molecule, then Cram's rule would not apply. Anti-Cram rule would apply. Anti-Cram rule. So what the anti-Cram rule is actually, if large group is sent to the carbonyl. So here you can see large group is sent to the carbonyl. Okay. Then the nucleophile would attack actually from the side of the smaller group. So you can see here, a smaller group is what? Hydrogen. And this, the stereochemistry of this hydrogen is what? It is actually upside. So this would also approach from the upside. That means top face or upside attack of this one. That means it is approaching from the upside, and when it is approaching from the upside along with the electron, this would go down. And if you draw now, it will have this. And I am writing it in this way. And rest part is your actually whatever is there in the example actually. So I can write it OP, PH and BH. Next your methyl. Okay. Which is below the plane. Or whatever this. Forget about this one. Doesn't matter. But here you see this hydride has approached from above the plane, just like your hydrogen. So this hydride would also be above the plane. When it is above the plane, chiral center is producing. That means your OH group, which was attaching here actually, it would go downside. So this product actually, you should focus here only. You should focus here only. Okay, now you can see in the options given here, hydrogen is upside, OH is downside, and you are getting this one. Hydrogen is downside and OH is upside, which is not there. So your option number C is the correct answer. But mind you, this is not a very, very simple problem. Actually, this is a very conceptual problem, and you should know lots of things to solve such kind of problem. Okay, whenever the chelation would occur, then you will use the anti-Cram rule, but not your Cram rule. Now the question comes, in which cases we will use our Cram rule, and in which cases we will not use your Cram's rule. So this you should know. Say generally, see how chelation is occurring here actually. This is additional actually. I have solved the problem. This I have explained additionally. Cerium is there. Cerium 3 positive. It can coordinate here. Okay. For chelation actually. This is actually the chelation. So if cerium is there, it can form a chelate. Okay. Similarly, you see if magnesium is there, then the chelation would occur. Then for zinc 2 positive, the chelation would occur. For copper 2 positive, the chelation would occur. Right. Similarly, Mn2 positive, this chelation would occur. Okay. But you see, if you have your, say, sodium ion and potassium ion, they are the monovalent one. So they cannot undergo the chelation. So in that case, or say the lithium ion. So chelation would not occur in that case. This is very, very important. And you see the heteroatom, right? If heteroatom, what kind of heteroatom should be there in the large group, right? These heteroatom could be anything. It could be your O, R, like here, you see oxygen is there, or say you can have your Nr2, because nitrogen can also form chelate. And similarly, you can have Sr, sulfur is also there. If these groups are there in the as heteroatom in the alpha carbon of this carbonyl, then the chelation would occur along with these metals actually, right? If you are having these metals, there would be no chelation. And whenever the chelation would occur, you will go for the anti-Cram rule. So however, I will make a separate full video on the Falcon and approach and the Cram's rule. But to solve the problem of CSIR net based on this Luche reduction, This I think is quite sufficient. This is very, very important, right? But what you can do, you can go through the SIN archive or the organic chemistry portal. You can find the various examples and solve and do the practice of such kind of the questions, guys. Okay. So, this is the end of this lecture. And if you are new here watching my video for the first time, or you are the regular viewer, what you haven't subscribed the channel yet. So kindly subscribe the Tetrahedron chemistry classes and do share the videos. If you are liking this video, do share with your friends, right? And don't forget to press the bell icon for the latest notification. Thank you. Thank you very much.